And greetings once again to all of you Atom Cats and Rust Devils of the Commonwealth. It's been a long time coming, but it's finally here. A new and substantial update to ENB series for Fallout 4. In terms of new effects, ENB 0.307 introduces some of the proverbial big guns we've all been waiting for. Not those big guns. What we're talking about here is the introduction of ENB's legendary ambient occlusion and indirect lighting effects, as well as some initial environment parameters that allow for manipulation of global lighting attributes. In this video, we will take a look at both ambient occlusion and indirect lighting, including visual demonstrations, configuration tips, and some basic performance metrics. The new environment parameters introduced with ENB 0.307 will be covered in a separate video, as there's just a lot to cover here. Alrighty, let's get started. Part 1, Ambient Occlusion and Indirect Lighting, Effect Overview. Ambient occlusion is a screen space effect that calculates how exposed each point in a scene is to ambient lighting. Areas with less exposure, such as recessed corners and crevices, are darkened accordingly. Some of you may already be familiar with ambient occlusion and some of its more commonly implemented variants, such as SSAO, HBAO, SSDO, HDAO, and so on. ENB's implementation of ambient occlusion differs from each of these in a number of ways, one of which is the inclusion of an indirect lighting component, rarely found in video games or other graphics mods, though I do believe recent versions of Reshade now offer some version of this effect. In this scene, note how the underside of the car is illuminated by light reflecting onto it from the ground. As we toggle ENB's ambient occlusion effect on and off, note how this illumination is also affected. ENB's version of ambient occlusion also tends to provide broader range and coverage than other versions of this effect. The effect is also very temporally stable at its default settings, with virtually no noticeable shimmering or noise artifacts while in motion. While indirect lighting is a rather subtle effect, when employed along with ambient occlusion, these effects can really help to make objects appear more convincingly situated in the environment created by the game world. Okay, let's take a look at how to enable and configure ENB's new ambient occlusion effect. Part 2, Setup and Configuration. First off, before booting up the game, you will want to go into the Advanced section of the Fallout 4 launcher settings to ensure that the game's own ambient occlusion effects are not being used, since we will be using ENB's effect instead. Just go ahead and make sure ambient occlusion is set to none, as shown here. Okay, let's go ahead and boot up the game. As always, we open our ENB interface by hitting Shift-Enter. We won't be needing our shader parameters or ENB series panels today, so I will go ahead and minimize those. Now, in the ENB series.ini panel, expand the effects section and make sure that Enable SSAO is selected. Next, let's expand the new SSAO SSIL section to reveal the parameters for ambient occlusion and indirect lighting. The first option we see here is a toggle for Use Indirect Lighting. However, like a few of ENB's other effects, simply toggling this option has no effect unless you also Save and Apply Settings in the ENB Series panel, as shown here. Most ENB effects can be configured in real time without this Save and Apply process, but a few parameters do require this. An easier way to disable indirect lighting for testing purposes is to simply lower the IL amount value to zero, though disabling the effect entirely can actually help with performance, as we'll see later, though of course this is at the cost of some eye candy. Okay, now the next two options, Resolution Scale and Source Texture Scale, can actually only be modified by editing the ENB Series .ini file while the game is not running, and as such they are grayed out in this interface. These two settings also have the greatest impact on the performance of the effect, though we will be sticking with the default values for now. Next up, we have sampling quality, which defaults to a value of high. There is a very high option also available, though to my eye, there is little discernible difference between this and even the lower quality options. If in doubt, just leave this at high. Next up is sampling range. This parameter determines the tightness of the effect, so to speak. At lower values, the shadowing is more detailed, but only darkens surfaces that are in very close proximity. While at higher values, the shadowing is more broad, but also affects larger portions of the scene geometry. I recommend a value between 0.15 and 0.25 for sampling range, as the default value of 0.2 feels fairly balanced overall. Next up, we have AO intensity. And you will notice here that we have separate controls for interiors as well. ENB only considers interiors to be areas that you enter through a door, so this Red Rocket garage we are in here is not actually considered an interior. The AO intensity parameter controls the overall darkness of the shadowing effect, as seen here. Next in line, we have AO amount, which also includes separate interior controls. This functions similarly to AO intensity, but affects the strength of the effect in a different manner. I generally leave AO intensity at a value of 1.0 and use the AO amount parameter for configuration of this effect. I generally reduce these from their default values of 2.0 to somewhere between 0.5 and 1.0 to keep the shadowing from appearing too heavy. Moving along, we have IL amount parameters, which affect the strength of the indirect lighting effect in the same way that AO amount affects the ambient occlusion effect. And again here, we have separate controls for interiors. I like to leave both of these at the default value of 4, and this is the value that's used throughout this video. One nice little feature you can see here is that for many parameters, you can click and hold on the parameter name and drag your mouse clockwise and counterclockwise to raise and lower the values in real time. This is very helpful in fine-tuning these parameters to your liking. And finally, we come to the AO mixing type parameter, also with separate controls provided for interiors. This setting affects the way that the ambient occlusion and indirect lighting effects are blended into the underlying image. And modifying these also require for you to click Save and Apply Changes in the ENB series panel in order for the change to take effect. I generally recommend keeping these both at 2 for the stability of the effect across different game environments. Though as always, feel free to experiment. Okay, and let's take a stroll outside to take a closer look at ENB's indirect lighting effect. Again, this effect simulates the reflection of bright light from one surface onto another, sort of like the inverse of ambient occlusion. In this scene, notice how the underside of the vehicle is slightly illuminated by the sunlight being reflected off the ground. If we disable indirect lighting in the ENB menu and click Save and Apply Changes, you will notice that this illumination disappears. If you adjust the sampling range parameter in the ENB menu, you can see that this also controls the range of the indirect lighting effect. At low values, the illumination is restricted to a smaller area, while at higher values, the illumination covers more of the geometry. Here's another example of the indirect lighting effect, with the underside of the pink udder of the milk machine illuminated by sunlight reflecting off the ground. Let's go ahead and set the AO intensity value to its minimum value, 0.01, so that we can look at the indirect lighting effect on its own. Now we can toggle ENB on and off with Shift F12 to see the impact of just this effect on the scene, including the illumination of the milk machine, the wooden planks on the ground, the truck chassis, and even the grass. Here we can see indirect lighting working its magic in an interior scene, where light reflecting off the wall on the right illuminates the nearby box and cabinet. Let's take a look at a few more comparison shots of some interior scenes to see how these effects help to enhance depth and the volumetric feel of geometry in these types of environments. And now, let's pay a quick visit to Diamond City to see how the complex geometry in this area benefits from ENB's new effects. Notice how the soft shadowing affects geometry throughout the scene, including objects well off in the distance. And let's toggle on and off the indirect lighting effect once more to better see how the effect is applied to this colorful metal fixture here. It is worth noting that since ENB's indirect lighting effect can be used on its own, this effect can be paired with either of Fallout 4's own ambient occlusion effects, SSAO, or HBAO if desired. Though, be advised, this is likely to tank your performance a bit. And speaking of performance, let's take a quick look at the performance impact of these new effects. Part 3, performance. For this exercise, we will be monitoring GPU load with MSI Afterburner in the top left corner, and we will only have the new Ambient Occlusion effect enabled, and we will also look at performance with the Indirect Lighting component enabled and disabled. However, let's first revisit the resolution scale and source texture scale parameters we glossed over earlier. So, to modify these, simply open the ENB series .ini file in your Fallout root folder and scroll all the way down to the new SSAO-SSIL section. The default values here are 1.0 for resolution scale and 0.5 for source texture scale, and these are what I will use for performance testing. If you have a beefy rig, you can try increasing source texture scale to 0.75 or 1.0 to help improve quality at the expense of performance. Or alternately, if you have a not so beefy rig, you can try reducing resolution scale down to 0.75 or 0.5 to help improve performance. The effect still looks pretty good with both of these values at 0.5. In any case, when done editing the file, just save and close and boot up the game. Okay. Back in the game now with the ENB mod disabled. My frame rate is currently capped at 30, though we can see that my GPU, an Nvidia GTX 780M, is running at a load of about 56%. And now when I enable ENB with only the ambient occlusion effect active, we can see that GPU load jumps up to about 74%. So clearly this is a fairly demanding effect, though the actual impact can vary quite a bit depending on the complexity of the scene. Now, let's disable the indirect lighting component of the effect only and see what impact this has on performance. So, we will uncheck Use Indirect Lighting and then click Save and then Apply Changes in our ENB series panel. We can see here that the GPU load has now dropped to about 68%, so it is clear that disabling indirect lighting completely can help improve the performance of the effect. Alright. Now let's see how the performance of ENB's ambient occlusion compares with the performance of Fallout 4's own HBAO and SSAO offerings. Starting off with ENB completely disabled, we can see that GPU usage hovers around 63% in this scene. And when we enable ENB using only the ambient occlusion effect with indirect lighting also enabled, we see that GPU usage jumps up to around 75%. And when we disable ENB again, GPU usage drops back down to the low 60s. Next, let's take a look at the performance of the game's own HBAO effect. In this case, we have ENB completely disabled once again, and GPU usage here tends to hover above 75%, closer to 77% or so. This suggests that HBAO can be even more demanding on performance than ENB's ambient occlusion effect at its default settings. Who would have guessed? Finally, we'll look at the performance of the game's own SSAO effect. Again, with ENB completely disabled, we can see that with SSAO, GPU usage only jumps up to about 68% or so. Clearly, SSAO is the most performance-friendly option here, but it is also the least attractive, most would argue. Alright folks, be sure to stay tuned for my next video where we will be looking at the new environment controls introduced with ENB 0.307. Leave a comment to let me know what you thought of the video, or if there are other subjects you'd like to see covered in a future video, just let me know. As always, I want to thank you for joining me. Be sure to stay tuned for more updates about ENB and other visual and performance mods for Fallout 4. Catch you next time.